you, I know, are artists. All of you, I mean, I know y'all, you know, you're artists in some way or another. You're word artists, you're visual artists, you're musical artists, you're wonderful photographers, you know. And that state of mind when you wake up, sometimes I call it like amoebas, you know. You wake up and you know your body is being taken over, your mind is being taken over, your consciousness is being taken over by this organism, and it's moving, and it's shaping, and, you know. And then it goes dormant for a while, and you, like I say, I open the door, and it's like, you know, and there was a party there yesterday, and now you open it up, and there's nothing there but empty glasses. You know, I got looking for my muse, and there's no one home, you know. I'm very much a poet of the muse, capital T, capital M. So this is a poem about that state, and it's called This Morning. This morning stilled into a moment of pure dreaming. I looked out over the long grass of winter light and rain and saw 100 robins, as red and belly as drunkards, all soaking it up, telling it their way. They were there, posing like boxers in the whirling earth. They were throwing their heads behind them as the water rolled. It was as if they were laughing, as if the whole soaking world was something to laugh. They were an element of song. They had the ultimate authority to do things. I watched them through the greased window, watched the living reduced to a bad reproduction of streaks and misprints. Just when clarity dinged like a bell of sunlight, the blade of grass, the vision changes. The light dives and I dream incomprehensible dreams of stars imploding, supernovas, the black holes of sex. I dream all I could ever be, all I would dare describe. I wake in sweat, hear the roar and surf made by the swishing autos. I wonder if I dare get out of bed. My head, that heron's egg, sits on top my shoulders, all bone and misleavings, all drool and mumbling words, all signals droning in my brain, simmer to a whine of silence so shrill only a dog could hear. I am driven from this world alive. I come to this world in dreams.
Yeah.
I was just going to read one poem from here, but I think I'll read this one to start off the reading of Ciento. Ciento is a book of love poems. When I was not actually in love, the poems, most of the poems, 98% of the poems are written, there's 100 of them, so 98, two of them are elegies, so, and they were definitely to one person, and definitely written for that one person, and out of a feeling of love for that one person, but 98% of the other ones were not about anybody in particular at all. I was not in love. Instead, I was in a state sort of like this poem. This is a poem called Cafe Solo or Cafe Solo. Imagine me walking down the rainy streets of the mission alone. I loved you with the scientific excuse of the lonely. Now I watch the streets smog out of focus or zoom in brutally on the tragically beautiful. My eyes have met no one's all morning. I've forgotten the purr of my name. I remember only the brush of my cat's teeth when she tells me she loves me. For weeks, the only lesson I've learned is that the leaves of the apple are finally turning. Everything has let go. There are days now that go by without a sound. I could be anyone. Once I was a person who loved you.
After that book, my second book was From the Tables of Genocide, Poems on Love and Hunger. And these have actual, real love poems to someone when I was in love or out of love or, you know, these are like, you know, and they were so hard to write, and it takes me so long. And like I said, inspiration, the muse, whatever. I had a friend, Victor Martinez, another mission poet who passed last spring. And we used to get, and we were friends for a long time. He was a part of my small press, Mongo. You know, he'd hang out, give us inspiration and stuff. And we'd always get in this argument. He'd tell me, you know, why do you have to have such angst to write? You know, you're like a carpenter. See, like a carpenter. You get up in the morning, you drink a cup of coffee, you know, you strap on the tool belt, you get the hammer, you get the nails, you put another nail in the board. What's the problem? Why do you have to have all this, you know, heebie-jeebie stuff? You can get me so mad. But anyway, so after a year putting together this book, From the Cables of Genocide, Poems on Love and Hunger, that's got to win the Guinness Book of World Records for the most poems, consecutive poems dedicated to one person, you know. And I call it Bob's Curse, my writing teacher, my guru, my poetry guru, Robert Haas. Who won the MacArthur Award and, you know, Genius Grant. I knew he was a genius back then. But when I gave him the manuscript for this book, he loved it. And he said, well, you know the problem, don't you, with having a book of poems that's dedicated all to one person is that by the time the book is out, the relationship is over. Now, you know, by the time this book was out, you know, I hated reading from it. I was like, oh, my God.
Why was I in love?
So these were written as sort of word meditations. These were posted anonymously. I had absolutely no idea, no one, anyone, that I was going to have a book of them or anyone was actually going to read them. And their word meditations, 100 words. So I go to this website, get a word. Everybody else is writing like prose things, you know, about whatever, you know, 100 words, at least 100 words. And I thought, okay, well, I'm a poet, so it's got to be a poem, you know. And I thought, well, okay, it's got to be a love poem. So every word, it had to be a love poem. So this is how this piece was made. All right. What is your favorite number? Say, favorite number from 1 to 100.
Nine.
And these were all written consecutively. Oh, it's one of my favorite ones, actually. These were, I don't know which ones the numbers are. These were all written consecutively, 100 weeks, what is that, like a year and 3/4 or something like that? However many months that is, 100 weeks, how many, a year or something, a couple of years. 100 words over how. I don't bear a grudge for the heart. The word that week was grudge. 100 words over how I don't bear a grudge for the heart. I don't carry a grudge against the government. I have the nation of you. I have your hands and what they can do. I have the heart of you, special core of your purpose and power. I have the gift of your sweat-stained sage, your hummingbird's bliss, sanctuary that you would find in me. I don't carry a grudge for any mortal. I have the fire of you. I don't bear a grudge for the stars, the shifting planets,
seize, repel, and contract all those contracts of a moth, broken and otherwise. I have this treaty with the heart. Another number. I love these. It's like tarot cards.
Favorite number five. Five. My father's favorite number.
Special number five. Bound. Bound. 100 words to you. You can read this one to John when you get home. I was bound to love you. Bound by the possibilities of you. The sea under your stars. The long rehab loving the lit bed of your making. The way you love those places of swell and salt, thrust and gush. I was bound to follow your crumbs, the leftover pillars, the awestruck wake. I'm bound to travel across the length of your languorous continent, bounding through the map of you, lost in the promise, wet haze of your gaze, propelled by what gazes back. You, your spirit-hardened heart, words whipping into binding, me bound to say it, transformed by you.
Yeah. Another number.
Yeah, that is funny.
What was that, something five?
25.
Oh. 25. By the way, if you have the book, you should have the book. If you have the book, that little, where the number is a Chumash petroglyph from the cave. It's a constellation. It's like one of the Novas or something. This glyph, it's a Chumash glyph. My grandmother was Chumash, so I was, we were trying to figure out, my publisher and I, I wanted to put the numbers, but I did not want them to be part of the title. I didn't want to know. I vowed never to think in numbers after I got out of high school, so this was a fun kind of ironic play for me. Okay, 25. Kaleidoscope! How cool!
Kaleidoscope.
100 words to the kaleidoscope of you. And you can read this one to your honey. Or maybe she should read it to you, come to think of it. Baby, let me twist your tube. Let me dial you up a new dimension. Let me see you in 1,000 lights. Let me eye you into infinity. Let your lips and legs go akimbo. Give me all your smallest, give all your smallest bits to me. Let me gaze through you into your he-art, into the many factors, into the paradise of your multiple rainbows, each color, another note in the inner song, each fine slice of you served up on a spinning plate. Let me handle your changes. Ride past your infinite divisions. Let me turn you around. Help me see through you. Another number.
93.
93. That was you?
Yeah.
You play? Would you like to play?
Play?
Yeah, with your boat? You play?
It's not a boat. It's a stick.
Oh, it's a stick. Oh, okay. It looks like one of like Jorge's bows, just looking at it. What was that again? 90? What? 93. Repassed. Some of these words, they just show up, and I got to write a poem about them. And then we got to be able to write a love poem. And some of these words I have to look up. So what repassed was one of the ones I had to look up and use a thesaurus. Repassed is like, anyone know that word?
Snack.
It's like a snack, exactly. You know that word?
Yeah.
Cool. This one's for you. Like I said, it's like they're like tarot cards. You know, this is your card. 100 words for past, repast. What we have is repast. A mere refection, entremont, a side order of side dish. You made me feel full of you, your nimble wit. Life with you could have been a picnic, a tea time déjeuner. Now, you want to feed me this plowman's lunch, cheesy cracker and a single stock. Come on, man, not even collation. What supper would subsist of this tiffin, this element? The heart slows when it sees you on the table. There'll be small bites tonight. Not much else to nosh for this dish. In past, our repasts resemble Thanksgiving. All sit down sweet. And now, chow.
Yeah.
Another number.
Hungry.
You want one for hungry? There is one for hungry in there. There's two, and two for poverty. When I got the word poverty, I had to do two of those. Another number.
17. Who was that back there? 17.
17. Oh, see, like I said, I never know what word's going to come out. And then it had to be a poem, and then it had to be a love poem. And some of these words I had to look up, but this is one, believe it or not, I did my doctoral study in history of consciousness, continental philosophy, indigenous American philosophy, cultural theory, semiotics. I know the word latitudinarian. Anyone know the word latitudinarian?
No.
Naomi can't answer. You know the word latitudinarian? Oh my goodness. It was like a 19th century political movement of tolerance, latitudinarian. It was sort of like liberal. It was like a new thing, you know. Indians were like a brand new world back there for them, you know, the 1800s. The French got all excited about freedom and liberty, and, you know, well, maybe the government shouldn't be so. Maybe we should have a more relaxed attitude. So this was a political movement of latitudinarians.
Okay.
So this was 100 words on loving the latitudinarian you. So you must be kind of latitude. You were kind of latitudinarian. What I love about you goes beyond your latitudinarian attitude. It's in the feathers you prey on, the wind in your sage, the amber copal of your eyes, red cedar smoke you use to speak to the ancestors. I love the trail of tears in your history you carry between your eyes, that book of laughter and forgetting you leave to me at night. It's in your hands with their smudged knuckles, the old remnants of the blows there, the fist of your heart beating in a gentler time. I love the ruleless you, the me I find in you. In other words, welcome. Come on in. There's food. There's free food. Come in. Help yourself. Enjoy some love poetry. 100 word love poems. You're coming late. I'm going to pay attention.
Yes, yes. Today's the 27th, and it's my daughter's birthday.
Oh! Oh, all right. Yeah, all right. 27. Ah! Exact.
Three,
100 words in the exact moment of you. I want to be there at that exact moment when you know you love me. When you feel that waterfall down your spine and into your solar plexus. When the winds of change change you and your smile sails ships of its own. I want to be there when you discover me. A deserted island of your own making. When summer recovers our skin, a soft pelt dissolving upon contact. When all the ice of other touches melt upon our heat. And all the rivers in our veins open up in utter orbit. I'll be there. Exactly. Totally. Same.
Exactly. And that was to add to.
Thank you.
One of the things I was doing with this book, especially once I realized, I got about to 48 or something, and I decided to copy them all from this website that I was posting them in, and realized that I had almost like 48 poems there, and I really liked them. I started reading them, and I really liked them. Like I said, I didn't get rid of any of them. They're all there. Anyway, I realized that it came out of something that I was doing when I was divorcing and living in Boulder before I decided to quit my job and leave my house in Boulder and just come back home to the Bay Area, to San Francisco. Yeah, with all of you cool, strong mujeres. I thought, man, I got to be home. I got to be home. But one of the things that, I was doing at that time was I started putting together playlists of love songs, you know, the greatest love songs. And I got really interested in love songs because they're like crystals, you know. I had a lot of friends when I was in high school who were seriously, seriously into healing with crystals. And they would always talk about how crystals, you know, there's something, I don't know if you hold it in, I think you hold it in your left hand and you turn it counterclockwise or clockwise or something under a, preferably a river running water to rinse off everybody's energy, you know, other negative energy, to recharge it. And then it recharges in your hand as you're turning it, right? You know, then it becomes your crystal. It becomes your power object. Well, love songs and great love songs are like that, right? Bummer love songs and good love songs, right? You know, the ones that, you know, made you cry and cry over Michael Nalen at 14, you know. You know, I mean, I still hear those songs, and, you know, Smokey Robinson, and it's like, oh, man, I'm there. And it's totally relevant to whatever relationship I'm in at the time. See, this is what I was interested in, how love songs can recharge. One of my Moon Alice friends here, one of the bands I really, really love, Moon Alice, they do their own songs and stuff, you know. I mean, that's what I get out of it, you know, those love songs that keep, you know, even though you heard them 30 years ago and if somebody's covering them, and it's like, you know, they recharge. So I like to think of these poems in the same way. It's like crystals or like rechargeable love songs. So it's like, you know, I'm not, and it's great because they're not connected to any particular person. So I can, you know, and you're free to, you know, I want to make note cards out of these so that you can give them to your loves or your potential exes, too. There's some of those, too. Another number. 10? 10, back there. 10. Secret. We got secrets, huh? Sarah, are you back there?
I'll pick some more Merlot.
Why not? It's a party! Put it on my cat.
Make it a double.
I'm going to be reading about secrets here.
Uh-oh.
100 words to your secrets. I'm sworn to the secrets of you, sworn to secrecy regarding your secret lust. for living, your giving ways, the way you unroll me like a packet of nickels, spend me to a dime, leave me an expired ticket to your floating showboat, all the secrets in one lonely face, reveal the smile you take, unveil the excruciating detail of you, your leaving, your twisted laugh, the dark hair under your pink thumb. All the trust in roar has nothing on your design. My desire for your touch leaves me in a place I could never tell you.
This is so fun. Like I said, tarot cards, you know. I remember when I wrote that poem and showed it to a friend, and the friend said, I don't understand that line, the dark hair under your pink thigh. Well, see, you got one of those little hair things, you know, like bobcat, you know. Right there, the little hair chin right there under your lips, under your thigh. See, the dark hair under your thigh. So perfect visual, you know, visual aid for that image. Another one.
Number 69.
69. That's a lot of numbers.
Big one there.
It's not what you think.
100 words of goodbye. Just 100 words of goodbye. This first day taken, this first new year, extravagant in its pleasure of red, its greenery hills, it's winding down to you and past the warmth of your shoulder, your stroke, past the filigree of smiling eyes, your strong arm wrung. I'm writing 100 words for goodbye. I'm staying on in my future, not a perfect tense. I'm holding on to the pluperfect past of you. I'm addressing your finest nature. I'm appealing to the head of your heart. I am breaking some pact of independence, some right to bear arms.
Yeah.
Another one.
Ten.
What?
Ten.
No, ten. Oh,
Ten.
No one ever asked for that one. Much less the way you did. So thank you. This is one of my favorite ones. The website that I was playing with, you know, on this, sometimes we could do our own words, you know. And once I started doing, you know, once I decided, okay, I'm going to do a book of these, I made sure I didn't choose the words, so I'd be totally surprised, you know, and then write the poem spontaneously to whatever word came out. But when it got to 100 and I knew it was the end, I thought, oh, okay, let me do the word. I'll do the word this week. The word this week, the 100th week, is last for the last poem. You have to imagine. Did you see that movie Cadillac Ranch about what's his name who produced the records of Elvis Presley and all those people? Etta James. He discovered Etta James and recorded Etta James. So you got to hear Etta James sing At Last. Go on YouTube. It's usually on my Facebook link, you know, but it's not easy to get to those links anymore. You know, but I love Etta James At Last. So this is, I'm not going to sing it, you know, but this is to the tune of At Last. 100 words for you at last.
at last, love has come at last. Last time love came, all it was quest. At last, a lasting love is guest. A visiting heart came over, and lover, it's all I'll ever do, all I can ever see, to win your skip beat for me. Consider this, please, a love you can return to, a sunny name where you can at last turn to. And what am I but the next stop onto you? You know you'll do at last. My love has come again. It's been so long, I don't know when, until I loved you last.
I'm going to just stop here, right? I don't want to go on. I was going to give a couple of sets, but you're already here, and there hasn't been too many people coming in and out. So can you hear a few more?
Yeah.
Yeah, more numbers. Who hasn't played?
Number nine.
Number nine.
What's
that?
We did that one already.
Seven.
Not nine, seven? Oh, yeah, you already did nine.
Yeah. How about 97?
7 and 97?
Yeah.
You want 7? Radiance. 100 words to radiance. Crepuscular means like the morning light, the morning dew light, first sunrise. You, in your radiant crepuscular light, your succulent heart, sex-sucked lips, your twining hair all halo and sash, you fill like the hummingbird, suckle, stay. I am radiant to imagine you, half animal, half staff of ember, your lightning rays of mirth, unimaginable in the dark, in other than holding you in a spirit land, whisked away to grace my hand, the giving night, the airy dawn, the awakening from withdrawal. As the valley hunter's mist hangs around her love, river, I flow with you, fog struck and caught in your aperture, your appetite for me, your blessing kiss, eyes windstruck, radiant. And then somebody said 97? Is that right? 97. Unforgettable. This is another one. You got to think of Natalie Cole with her father, Nat King Cole, doing Unforgettable. This is also to the tune of Unforgettable. 100 words for unforgettable you. You're so unforgettable. You're so unregrettably you. I know you're so gettable. You're so unforgettable. You make statues of men who graze my glance. You have that brass, that manner, that classic stance. You remind me of no other. You are sweet, generous. It's end of the line for you. You're so unforgettable. You are, and the world is more memorable. When you're around, you make all the clues come true. Yes, you'll do. I'm sure you'll know when you want to be. Sure, you'll be where you want to be. Right here, in front of me. You, unforgettably you.
Yeah. 44.
I was just going to say, yeah, give me
never.
Yeah, I have.
Ask for one.
No, just not in public.
Cool. Notice. Okay, since y'all my friends, I will confess. These poems were posted under the screen name Julia de Burgos. Julia de Burgos was a Puerto Rican poet, one of my favorite poets. She was, at 16 years old, the youngest person to attend the University of Puerto Rico and the first woman to attend the University of Puerto Rico. This was in the 20s, the 30s, the 40s. She influenced people like Federico Garcia Lorca and others. She was an early feminist writer. Julia de Burgos, she was discovered in the Bowery in New York City, dead of alcohol poisoning and literally found in the gutter. And her body was unidentified for 6 weeks. This genius. Poetic genius. So I like to think I'm the least person who is least to be found dead in the gutter in the Bowery. So I use this name, Julia de Burgos, as a screen name, and it was an online dating site. So all of these poems are pretty much for seduction. If I could do a one-page study guide for these poems, and I just cracked up and I saw, how do you do that? You know, these poems were written to seduce you. So 100 words of notice. 100 words is all it takes to get you to notice me, noticing you, notice me. 100 words is all it took for you. 100 words is all it took for me to notice you. Notice the novel of your shadowed eyes, the twin stanzas of your fine hands, the miracle of your secret heart. 100 words is all it took for me to want the heart, the art of you, the watercolor of the night with you, the hidden waters of your singular river, want to lure along with your hook, your lead, your sinker. I want the living rhythm of you, the mundane day of you in your notice. Another one. The penultimate, 99,
shelter. This one's for you, Sarah. I love how you shelter me, the warmth within your heart, all that wood you have stored. I love all that wilderness in the heart of you, all that uncut lumber just waiting for my touch. I love the human path of you, all that trampling to get there, here, where a river runs through it, a shelter of smoke, of sensuous ribbons of past. Let me demonstrate. I will lay down my arms, play dead for you, wait for your resurrection. Take me. I know a road clear to there. It will get us to where we will last. Unless there's anyone with any extra numbers, I think it's time to go. Oh, one more, yes.
Number one. I think I will do the two number ones. Because when I discovered this, it was sort of like, you know, oh, great, I want to play 100 words. Great, you know, we write 100 words to, you know, whatever word there is, and I want to play. You know, I'm a writer. So what I did is I took a poem that I had, and the word when I joined in to play was possibility. So I had just written a poem which is why I was on the dating site. that had the word possibility. So I just edited it down to 100 words. So this is how I started this book. Possibilities in 100 words. After I said I was going to multiply the conditions of possibility, and you said, okay, good. I knew it was the wrong answer to the wrong question. And afterwards, every hummingbird was you. A murder of crows on my elm tree became you, finally calling my number. A slumber of vultures circling my apartment. A single red fox roaming my neighborhood. Beat up, but there. A leftover garden in a place someone is leaving. Hard red fox left over in the moon. After I said, I love you, you could have hammered me over the heart with the silence. And so after I did that one, I thought, okay, well, this isn't really, you know, I'm supposed to come up with something new to possibilities. So then I decided, okay, I'll write a new one. And this one was cool because it came out in four-line stanzas, just like that, and it had its own form, and it was exactly 100 words, and it seemed very magical, which got me interested in continuing playing with this 100 words towards possibility. Love is the possibility of doubting, the possibility of making a mistake, the possibility of searching and experimenting, the possibility of saying no and whispering yes. All the possibilities under your eyelids alight. A loft in your heart, a new timber for the flame, a new car in which you are the key, all the possibilities of you in a single line, a narrow column, filter through the sensors and commit, all the possibilities in a drop of rain, a moment of snow, a blank book by the fire. Love is the possibility. You'll wear it well, that new love now. Anyone else have any other pressing numbers? Otherwise, I want to read a couple. Just for the heck of it, one of the things, like I said, I was writing these poems, and I was writing them anonymously and posting them anonymously and not thinking about, you know, putting together a book or anything, and oh my gosh, I can't even find this poem. And the first time I read this book out loud when it was accepted was at the University of Oklahoma. In Norman, Oklahoma, so imagine a lot of very, very conservative white people in suits and sitting there from the English department. And Norman, I decided to read from my new book. It's going to be published, and, you know, okay. You know, and I'm calling out the numbers like this. I just decided to do it like that. And so somebody calls out 38. So here I am in Norman, and the first poem I read for this book is 100 words for my ass. And the thing is, like I said, they're like tarot cards, you know? It's like, you know, I just moved in with this wonderful, wonderful couple, but I, you know, they're very nice, but I'm sure they're also very conservative, you know? I get that feeling. And I show them my new book, and they open it up, and the husband opens up to this 100 words from my ass.
Oh, God.
But anyway, they're here. 100 words from my ass. You want the upward. 100 words for my ass. You want the upward path.
a long stream of vowels, some sweaty consonants, my perky verbs, 100 breathy fricatives. You express me more than move me. Olive oil in my row, a smooth slide to indecision, a lightsome ride for two. 100 words for just my ass. How many words for the view? How many acts of you will it take before this woman sings, before the ring of you? 100 words for my ass, worth a quarter or two. My peach, my apple half, what would you give to join the rest of few? Place alive. They're facing eviction, so anything you can donate at all to keep this space alive, please, please do. Thank you very much, Sarah.
Thank you,
Kaleidoscope. Thank you all for coming. Thank you.